Welcome to our Here to Be Heard podcast. This series is part of the larger Here to Be Heard global study at Mars to amplify and listen to the voices of women from all backgrounds and intersections of society. In the world we want tomorrow, society is inclusive. We've made progress, but there's still work to do. In this series, you'll hear the unique experiences of women of Mars who come from all parts of the business to get their perspective on what needs to change for women to reach their full potential. I'm Crystal Calloway, and I'll be your host for this episode. I lead global internal communications for Mars and have been with the company for a couple of years now. With me today is Dr. Maria Velisariu. She's the Global R&D Vice President and Chief Science Officer of Mars. Dr. Maria, thank you for joining us today. And will you start by just telling us a little bit about yourself and how long you've been with Mars?
Hello, Crystal. It's my privilege to be here today. I joined Mars in September of 2020, so I have been with Mars for just under 5 months now.
You know, in your bio, it clearly lists that you have 3 patents. That's very exceptional. Can you tell us a little bit about those?
It's a great question. It takes me back to the time when I was involved with product and process development, supporting innovation. And all my 3 patents are actually on beverages. 2 of them are related to coffee, and 1 is related to powder beverages. 1 patent in particular is about a beverage made from the coffee fruit extract. The coffee we drink is made from the coffee bean, and the coffee fruit is thrown away, and there is a lot of goodness there. And I'm particularly proud of this patent because it was not the most straightforward in terms of defining what the invention and the claims were, but I feel very proud. And unfortunately, the product never made it to market, but the patent was granted. The other patent on powder beverages was an effort by a number of scientists, and I was very privileged to work with some really brilliant chemists trying to solve the problem, which was solved to support a broader portfolio innovation. So as I said, every patent has a story, and I remember very fondly my patents.
It's very, very interesting and very in line with a lot of what we're doing in our Mars Edge segment. So you are a perfect fit here at Mars. I mean, I guess I'm really interested in how you even got your start. When you look back at university, you know, were there many women in your classes? And did you see many people who were pursuing the same interests in science that you were?
It was quite unusual to see a lot of women in engineering. I studied chemical engineering, which probably had the highest number of women. It was when I went to college, it was in my class, it was just under a quarter of the class were women. And it was, you know, we all worked together and we had a lot of fun, but you always felt that you were a minority. During my master's, I was 1 in 10, so it felt quite lonely. But in that process, you also realize that you develop life skills, you develop experiences that galvanize you, build resilience, and you find ways to chart your path forward. It's been wonderful to see more and more women in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, and to see those women come out of their academic studies and joining industry, joining academia, and see these numbers continue to grow. Today, women in STEM represent 1/3, and it is important that we continue to pay attention so that this number grows to represent the demographic split between men and women.
You have a couple of daughters. Are they interested in going into the STEM field?
None of my daughters went to STEM.
Oh, okay. That's completely fine. What are they interested in, by the way, Maria?
One daughter studied communications in Spanish, and the other daughter is a social justice warrior, and she's studying political science. My oldest daughter works for Goldman Sachs. My youngest is a freshman in college.
I love it. I mean, see, now you're talking communications, and I relate to her.
Yes.
That's really good. Well, is there any advice that you give your daughters, just, you know, still when we're working on breaking the glass ceiling for women, on how they can navigate their careers?
Absolutely. I tell them to be fearless and to pursue their dreams, to make sure that they get all the support that they need to remove barriers and achieve the best that they can achieve. My oldest daughter works in still a male-dominated environment. My youngest daughter, she's a freshman in college, but she has recently become an Eagle Scout. She was in the inaugural class of Eagle Scouts, and she is extremely proud to be among the girl pioneers. The Boy Scouts opened up to girls in the beginning of 2019. So the inaugural class, they were on an accelerated path to Eagle, to the rank of Eagle, which required a huge amount of effort in a very short period of time. And she attained the rank at the end of last year. And it was a very proud moment for her and for her cohort. And we're very proud of her. And we feel very privileged to be in a community where the local troop invested 20 years ago in actually preparing for that moment, opening up to the possibility of one day girls joining the Boy Scouts of America.
That's extremely impressive. I know that as a former Girl Scout myself, you know, we would still reach the top of the seniors, as they called them, in Girl Scouts, and you still wouldn't necessarily get the same respect as, you know, being an Eagle Scout in Boy Scouts, because they did send them through a more rigorous program at that point in order to achieve that level. So for your daughter to have done that is incredibly impressive, and I'm sure you're very proud, Maria.
We are.
Amazing. I guess I'm interested then, you know, it sounds like she's already ahead of the game. And as you look at what workplaces can do to really encourage, you know, young women in her situation or even those who are mid-level, do you see anything in terms of gender inclusion and diversity that either companies you've been at in the past, like Pepsi and Kraft, or that you've seen here at Mars, that they're doing really well to help women?
Absolutely. Investing in inclusion and diversity is a strategic investment, and it takes a long time to see the fruit, and it takes a systematic, sustained effort. Earlier in my career with Kraft, there was a significant investment in diversity with a focus on race and gender. And that original focus was based on the U.S. realities, and it was customized for regional needs. But the main focus outside of the U.S. was women. My previous role at Pepsi, I experienced significant investment in community outreach and some very regional efforts to address specific cultural sensitivities. And these regional efforts were successful at actually getting women into the workplace, particularly in traditional cultures that they had some high barriers. At Mars, we are seeing some very exciting region-specific strategies, and you know, we need to continue to develop them and encourage this momentum and energy, because we want to make sure that these investments, they have a multiplier effect and they touch across all corners of the world.
You make a really good point. Sometimes it's not just gender and sex that we have to look at with some of these inclusion and diversity policies that we're looking at, but also the regional specific nuances. Have you found that to be the case?
Absolutely. It is indeed the case. And we need to understand the local environment. And we need to understand the cultural sensitivities. In my previous role at Pepsi, I experienced community outreach with regional specific focus and strategies that were really successful at getting women into the workplace, even in very traditional cultures where women in the workforce are not very common. Also, I've experienced situations where underprivileged students, they needed extra mentoring and extra coaching support to overcome some challenges during the course of their studies, particularly in the second year. This seems to be the year where there is a need for additional support, particularly with boosting confidence. At Mars, we are seeing some really exciting region-specific strategies that we're developing And it's important to continue to encourage the momentum and energy so that we can spread inclusion and diversity and see the impact across all corners of the world.
It definitely helps when we meet people where they are. It really makes a difference, I think, when it comes to progress. Are you seeing that same progress in the fields of science and technology?
Absolutely. We are seeing a lot of progress, but the work is not done. So when we look at some statistics, we see the progress and we see what needs to be done. So let's take the field of inventors. When we look at women's names on patents in the mid-70s, women represented only 2 to 3% of the inventors. 40 years later, this number is much higher. It is 18% among academic inventors and around 12% among industry. However, if we wanted to see 50% of inventors being women to reflect the demographic split, it would take us 140 years. Well, we cannot wait for 140 years. So we need to find ways to expedite this process. The same goes for representation in the C-suite and in boards. We have seen significant progress, but we need to continue to work very hard at it because we're nowhere near where we need to be. And when it comes to pay equity, it is a mixed picture. So in the United States, across the workforce, we're seeing an 18% disadvantage for the pay of women. In STEM, it is much better. It is 91%, which means that actually women who study in the fields of science, technology, engineering, and math, they have better economic prospects. However, in food, we are seeing some really stubborn low numbers. The difference is 25%. And this is not acceptable. So there is a lot of progress that has been made, but more progress to be made.
It's encouraging to hear those stats that we have made progress, but you're absolutely right. There's a ways to go. So of all of the things that can be done, if you can name one, what needs to change so that more women can reach their full potential?
That's a really hard question. I think we have underestimated the importance of role modeling. Role modeling that starts from earlier in life, the formative teenage years, and carries through all the way to academic studies and early career. That's a very important time in life where young women have the opportunity to visualize and see what it looks like. So role modeling is a very important component for me that is up there together with mentoring and sponsoring and other measures associated with policy and key performance indicators.
Being able to see how women at those upper echelons and in those higher positions, you know, how they're able to get there and just to be able to see them, that makes a difference, huh?
Absolutely. Seeing is believing. And see people who look like you, they sound like you, they share experiences with you, is very important.
Is there anyone from your career or even, you know, that you've seen out in the world that gave you something to look up to?
Absolutely. I didn't know it at the time, but I realized it later in life. One of my professors in my undergraduate studies in Greece, she was a woman and she influenced me tremendously. When I did my PhD, there was a research fellow in the lab who became an incredible role model for me. And looking back, it was actually my mother who role modeled what education can do for you. For that, I'm very grateful that I had those three women who influenced me in such a profound way.
It sounds like you had an amazing circle, and we know how important that is. And we're hoping that through Here to Be Heard, we can have more women who are able to share their voices so that more people can reach where you are today. Now you are the example.
Yes. It's time to give back. And what I would say to the young girls today and the young women of today, I would say be fearless and pursue your dreams and ambitions. It's important to look for advice, take the advice as much as you can. And when you grow, remember to give back to those behind you.
I don't think we could wrap it up any better than that. Thank you so much, Dr. Maria Velisariu, for joining me today and for sharing your experiences and amazing advice. Thank you.
Thank you.
And that's a wrap on this episode of the Here to Be Heard podcast series. Our Here to Be Heard campaign is not just for Mars associates, but for women all over the world. So please visit beheard.mars.com to share your voice and vision for change. Mars will use this data to inform policies and procedures to help women to reach their full potential. And follow hashtag Here to Be Heard on your social channels to stay up to date on the latest news and stories. Don't forget to listen to the next episode of the Here to Be Heard podcast series, where there will be a new host, new guest, and new experiences shared. Thanks for listening, and until next time, remember, the world we want tomorrow starts with how we do business today.